And I'm delighted to welcome you to the studio because your book moved me as much as it obviously moved James Baldwin.
Thank you very much.
And it's Maya, not Mayor.
Oh, yes.
Hiya, Maya.
Thank you. I needed that.
Tell me, you've been a really big writer in the States. You've told me, to my shock and horror, that you've had 9 books out, whereas I'm only just beginning you've just started your first.
Yes.
You've been published along everywhere in Europe.
Yes. Why? And Africa and Asia.
Why not Britain until now?
I don't know, save to say that no publishers were as astute, profound, clear, intelligent, and bold as Virago Press.
Yes.
I have no idea. I'm the most read black female writer in the world. My books sell in the millions. And I have no idea why. I think some publishers suggested that people wouldn't be very interested in the exploits and the derring do of a black American girl. However, the truth is I write through the black experience. That's what I know. I'm talking always about the human condition, what it is like to be a human being, what makes us weep, what makes us laugh, what does us down, how sometimes our soul can look back and wonder how we got over. So I hope that when people read my work, and obviously this is so since there are more whites in the United States than blacks, obviously. And my books are read in universities, mostly required reading in most universities. I hope that I have told the truth about the human condition, not just the facts, because facts oftentimes obscure the truth. So if I tell the truth, then an Asian man in Hong Kong who still is so tradition-bound that he wears a plaid, can read it and say, that's the truth.
You see, in fact, I wasn't going to mention black when I refer to your book. I know one would have to pretty soon because you were born.
Well, I'm 6 foot tall and I've
and
been
you're
black
a long
time.
Not from the obvious quality of that, but from the fact that when I was reading your book, when I related to it,
yes.
It was relating to a person, a
right.
girl.
Yes.
Now, the thing about it is, though, that you do go back, you have almost a total recall, it would appear.
It would appear. I do seem to have total recall or none at all. I mean, and there is no rhyme nor reason to it. That is, those things I remember everything about them. The sound, the background sounds, the feel in the air, the odors around, the color. Everything. It's a strange kind of madness. But it's not because I remember the good things and forget the bad happily now. Or remember the bad. I mean, there is no rhyme. I can remember the good things and the bad. Then I forget millions of excellent things that I'm reminded, of which I'm reminded, and forget bad things as well.
Is it a painful process then? I mean, do you have to almost, whenever I've written something that I've really remembered about my past, I found myself shaking with fear of what I'm going to remember.
Yes.
It's
frightening. I go to work about 6:30 in the morning when I'm working on a book or a movie or a play. I'm always afraid. I keep a room in a hotel. And I go to the hotel and I have nothing in the room. No, I have them take out all the little things, those terrible little prints on the walls and all that. And then I'm afraid that once I get in, I might never come out.
That's right.
God, and who loves me enough to reach into that particular secret, mysterious place to hook me and pull me out?
It is like going into a tunnel of the past, isn't it?
And yet it's so, you know, it's what I do. I am a writer. I think sometimes it must be like a long-distance swimmer who sees the pool or the lake covered with ice and knows he or she must go in. That antipathy, that drawing back is natural. You know, however, that once in, And after a few very nice long laps, you know, you're going to be in your milieu. Mm. Mm. But it's getting in that's the drag, you know.
Mm. You didn't become a writer till fairly recently.
Well, I've written, I guess, but at my university, there are scrapbooks and papers of poems and essays I wrote from 9 years old. But that was because I was a mute, and it was during a time when all I had was were words and unspoken words.
Now, you became a mute. Mm-mm. You decided not to speak.
Yes.
Because you were raped by your stepfather.
Mm.
Is that as simple as that?
That's...
Yeah, no, I know.
Well, it's as direct as that,
maybe. I meant.
It's so unsimple, unfortunate. I mean, that thing that takes place in the brain of a child, male or female, black or white, when the child encounters catastrophic events is so complex, and how the child then tries to create some sort of mechanism to cope with that catastrophe. In my case, I decided that I would stop talking. And the man was killed.
Your stepfather?
He was killed.
What?
After I told who did this terrible thing, the man was killed. Well, I decided in my 7.5-year-old brain that my voice killed him. And so, had I not told, he would have been alive. And I took on all that weight. So I simply stopped talking.
Good Lord.
And it seemed to me quite logical. And I didn't talk again until I was 12.5.
That's extraordinary. I mean, to shut yourself into silence of that sort at that age.
Yes. You see, this is the logic, right? I was silent, but I wasn't in silence. All sounds became heightened. I memorized poetry, sonnets of Shakespeare. I fell in love with Shakespeare. I fell in love with Paul Laurence Dunbar and Edgar Allan Poe. I memorized whole bits of books so that when I chose, I could, like kids today, turn on the television. I could just
turn on your mind.
Right. And I loved music, and I listened to the Black American Ministers. And because of that intense listening, I believe, I've become a good writer. And a good composer. I compose scores for movies because of those years of... So I wasn't in silence.
Hmm. Do you think you did it to protect yourself? Was it a sort of, I can't bear any hurt anymore?
No, it was expiation, rather.
Yes.
It was an atonement. It was a punishment to myself that because I had, my voice had killed that man, I wasn't a very nice person.
Because it was very logical, wasn't it?
Yes, it seemed so.
Because you said who it was,
yeah.
And therefore that caused his death.
Mm. And you see, it was just the opposite. He had told me if I ever told, he would kill my brother, who was the only person I loved.
Mm.
And just the opposite, I told and he got killed. So, my Lord, that's a terrible weight.
Mm. But then, what kind of weight has it been that you were raped? Because it's a very distressing part in your book, a very distressing part. And how has that affected you, do you think, as a woman? Have you got rid of it? Have you forgiven?
Myself.
Not a man?
Oh, he was never in it.
Really?
It was never my concern. And I knew somehow that this man, who wasn't really married to my mother, he was my mother's boyfriend, had been unable to cope with this. She was a great beauty, and she was much sought after, and she's very exciting. And he was rather a thudding, kind of plodding guy, you know. And he couldn't hold on to this firefly
Judas.
He couldn't. And so I knew even then that it had really nothing to do with me. I knew that. Of course, the rapist is so egocentric. This is not to forgive it.
No.
It's simply to try to understand
it. Hmm.
He's so totally focused on himself that he cannot know that he is actually hurting. Not just physically, but psychologically scarring a person, maybe for life. So I wasn't involved with forgiving him.
Hmm. I was.
Until I was about 19, weighted with trying to forgive myself. Yeah, I know it's, but there we are.
Do you think that's common with people who have been raped? Women who have been raped? There was our program had done did a program on incest, and Carol, the producer, had done quite a lot into it, and she said that there was a noticeable thing about girls who had been raped or assaulted, who became prostitutes.
Yes.
Now you did.
Well, yes, but I don't know. They may not follow. At about 17, I had a son when I was 16. And I had, the first time I'd had sex, and I was very afraid. I mean, I went to have sex because I was 6 foot tall. I had no shape. I mean, when I pulled off my clothes, my body looked like a brown cucumber. There were little knots and bumps, you know? And so, and my voice was so low. I thought, oh my God, I'm becoming a lesbian. You know? It frightened me so. So I went to have sex with this man, a boy really down the street. And I thought, after, is that all? I mean, gee, oh boy. And of course, and I ended up pregnant. So I had the child. The greatest event of my life was the birth of my son and the growing up of my son. And then I left home after 2 months, although my mother was well off and all that, and offered to keep my son while I went on. I had a scholarship to university. But I remembered that she had left me when I was 3. And I didn't see her except for that disastrous moment.
Because you were brought up by your grandmother.
By my grandmother until I was 13. So I thought, if she didn't look after me and I was hers, why should she look after my son? I'll put him on my hip, which I did, and hit the street. And I mean hit the street, figuratively and literally. I didn't bounce either. I just splat on the street. When a person is reasonably intelligent, and, of course, none of us is quite as intelligent as we think we are. But when a person young is reasonably intelligent, and all the doors leading out to life are shut and there are no doorknobs, one falls into many things and will do almost anything. I don't think that my falling into prostitution was a result, I don't think, of the rape. Mm. I mean, I think at 16, I had a baby, and I was terribly confused, still terribly confused. But also, I wanted, dear Lord, how I wanted somebody to say, you're wonderful. So, a pimp told me I was wonderful and he just needed a little help. And I thought, well, there's nothing really wrong with this. I mean, I had read everything. I knew what was wrong with it. But I then, you see, in the second book, after Caged Bird, it's called Gather Together in My Name, and I hope my publishers will also publish it. I wrote about this period. And by that time, when I started to write about it, I had already become Maya Angelou, and I was a Chubb Fellow at Yale University, and all that.
Quite a jump from a tiny little town in the South to that.
Yes.
With
Yes.
And a black woman at that time.
Mm. But anyway, I thought I'd better write that book and tell it. Now, I know it sounds sensational, but I thought so many people lie to young people. And the streets in America are filled with the hopeless, the lost, the homeless, drug addicts at 13. And I think a number of them are inspired, if I might so badly use that word, by parents lying to them. Parents saying, "Oh, I never did anything wrong. Oh, my, never. Oh, my dad would have killed me. Oh, no, my mother, oh, no." And so a young person comes along having these urges, feeling lost, undecided, insecure, and he or she thinks, "Jesus, I must be a horrible person." Mm. You know? So I
think that's a particular age feeling.
Of course. So I wrote the book, and to say, and the book is called Gather Together in My Name, so that other people who don't have that kind of courage could gather in my name, I will tell it, to encourage young people to remind them that they may encounter many defeats, but they must not be defeated. And maybe it's necessary to encounter the defeats, to build some character, to develop some courage. So, as a result, after I wrote the book, I was so frightened. I was so frightened. Mavis, my God, girl, it was terrible. And I did the you know, New York to San Francisco and Los Angeles and the promotion tour, Thumping the Drum, right? And I'd go into the television. Now, before, people just adored me. Oh, my God.
Because of this first book, that's a beautiful South.
And the second book, which is a book of poetry, which was nominated for the Pulitzer. Ah. So there I was, and I had written the first screenplay and score for the screenplay, written ever by a black woman. And, they just, a little cutie putty. I came on this time. People went, bang!
Wonk. You got it.
Right. Tom.
Yeah.
So I thought, well, sometimes, my eyes were filled with tears, and I just straightened my back and say, that is what happened. Now watch and see me. Watch me and see. Watch. You think you can do me down? Darling, an entire society has tried to do me down, and look at me. And look upon me and be free. But inside my heart, and I would just...
You know,
God, it was terrible.
You, one thing I struck by you, and another, and it's linked with the commentary that I listened to on Martin Luther King, that crowd of 20,000 people, right?
No, 200.
200,000 people were not aggressive, were hopeful.
Mm-hmm.
And the other phrase that came out, which I was struck by, they were not bitter.
No.
Have you been bitter as a political activist then?
No.
Why not?
Well, it is obvious that bitterness is like cancer. It eats upon the host. Anger is healthy, I think. I think anger is like fire. It burns out all the dross and all the stuff. And I think it's wise to show it, to be opposed to injustice at all times for anybody. I think that's wise. I know that as soon as I feel myself insulted, the person who has insulted me is the second to know. As soon as I know, I say, "Hey, stop! Just a minute. Come here. I beg your pardon. You won't do that to me. That is your affair. Don't put that poison on me. I will not have it." So that's much healthier. And fortunately, it is creative. And that thing which is creative has a productive result.
But, not all blacks can feel not. I mean, some will feel bitter.
Yes.
I'm still interested why you weren't bitter, because you didn't like what white children even did to your grandmama.
No.
I mean, you were behind a screen watching her being insulted, and she majestically taking it. So I'm still interested as to why you didn't allow that bitterness to creep into your soul then.
It may be because my grandmother loved me a lot. I mean, I had that.
There's a great maternal feeling in your book all the time. Yes. Because your mother, too.
Yes, my
later
mom
on
is,
when you went. Yes.
She's hot, my mom. Also, I have a brother who loved me a great deal. There were those three people. I told you I was 5'11 by the time I was 15. And my brother, who is 5'4, who's older, and the closest thing to a genius in my family, my brother, told me that height had nothing to do with being female, nor anything to do with being male. That I would always speak softly. I would be gentle. I would look after myself. Of course, that didn't mean I had to be weak. Mm. And so all that, I think, kept me from ever falling into either that shorter, you know...
Yeah, pugnacious. Kind
of, pugnacious, exactly. Yeah. Pose. Mm. And it kept my heart tender somehow. Mm. I recognized that I'm a human being and nothing human can be alien to me.
Nor are you...
Terence.
You seem to be fearless. That's the other quality that I've noticed about you.
I'm afraid all the time, but I'm not afraid of anything.
You're not afraid of life.
No.
But therefore you cannot be afraid of death.
Mm-mm. Oh, no, I gave in to that, which was a great freeing production for me. Once I really admitted that I would die, that it is the one promise I can be sure will not be reneged upon.
That's true.
Once I understood that, then I could be present. And I'm totally present all the time. I try. Now, I don't make it all the time, but I try to bring all my stuff here in this studio. Everything I've got is here. And when I leave here, everything I've got will be in that taxi, it will be in the hotel.
But you see, that could be a dangerous philosophy if you think that you've got to live every single moment, because you could be greedy. You could be greedy, but you're not saying that, are you?
No.
You know, take everything I can now. No. You don't mean that.
No, maybe just the opposite. Give everything I've got. Not take. I mean, what is that? Give everything. All the time. Mm. It's great fun. And it is liberating. Absolutely liberating.
Have you got, by any chance, in your mind, got a poem to end? Because we've just got a tiny little while to
go. Really? How much, like? It depends.
Well, say 3/4 of a minute, maybe.
Oh, goodness. No.
Not a little line.
I do have a poem called And Still I Rise. It's a play, a musical in New York. It was. You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still, like dust, I'll rise.
That's brilliant.
It's a very long poem, and maybe the next time I come.
Yes, and now that you know where we live.
Thank you. And I'll sing, too.
And sing next time. All right. Promises, dance. Promises. Dance as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Mavis.
Maya, very much.
Thank you.